Okay, there is a portion of a lesson that we were discussing that really intrigued me, but I just wanted to share the thing that really held on. Lesson. This is lesson four. I've been challenged tremendously by the area of the lesson that Jesus was totally dependent upon his Father for all of the works and things that he did, and how that can relate to us today. And how does it relate? Jesus was totally trusted and dependent upon God for his anointing and power. And I guess the question is that how does it relate to us today? Or did Jesus do the thing that he did as a man, or did he do it as God? If he did all of these things, with the same power and ability that he did before he became man, then that would tell us that we are at an unfair advantage. You know, how can we expect to do the same works that Jesus did? How many believe that the works that Jesus did are the same works that we are to emulate today, we are to do? Amen. Amen. So what was the secret? Not only Jesus did these works, but the apostles also followed his steps. They did the same works that he did. They did works that were even greater. Amen. So sometimes when we look at the challenges, sometimes we feel helpless and hopeless and feel like there's no way that we can even begin to measure up to doing the things that Jesus did. But we have to take into consideration that Jesus did all that he did, not as God, okay, but for their scriptures, which very easily will clarify this, because Jesus, he says that the glory that I had with my Father from the beginning, he said that after he had finished his works and ready to go back to heaven, this is what he said. He says that this was in St. John 17. He asked the Father to restore back to him the glory that he had with his Father, amen, before the foundation of the world. And if you can convince yourself that Jesus did everything that he did as a man anointed of God, just like we are men and women anointed of God, I think that you would really begin to see things from a much different perspective. And you will begin to see Jesus in a different light. In the ministry that he has given us, we would see that as something that would be attainable to even the weakest of all of the believers in the body of Christ. Now, how many believe that the weakest person in the body of Christ can do the works of Jesus? Amen. So you have to look at it from the perspective that Jesus said that the works that I do and the things that I do, I'm not doing them by my what? Myself. But the Father in me, he's what? He's doing the works. If you look at it from that perspective, amen, I can trust in God too. I can yield to God, Jesus yielded in prayer. Amen. The apostles prayed until they got boldness.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
Strange things happen when you yield to God. Uh-huh. Amen. I think that one thing that happens, you step out of the realm of your own strength, and you begin to what? Amen. Amen. You begin to what? Amen. Flow into that realm where you're completely what? Relying and trusting in God. Oh, I wish I knew Sister Denise, how I could just told you. Wouldn't you just like to tell them? Amen. What do you think that we got to do to come to the place where we are totally relying on God? It doesn't seem like it's a big deal to me. What do you have to do to come to the point? Because when you get to the end of your strength and your puny ability, it seems like God's power and strength kicks in big time. Amen. Paul said, in my weaknesses, in all of my afflictions and problems, he says that when I'm weak, then I'm what?
Strong.
I can do all things through who? Christ that what strengthens me. I think the greatest revelation that we could have is, hallelujah, how can we come to the point where we can totally and completely trust and rely on God to do the works? Amen. To do the works that through us that he wants us to do.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. A bigger revelation would be a revelation of God is at work in you. God dwelling on the inside. God, that is God that's dwelling in me.
Amen.
And it's he that's doing the works. Amen. That scripture in, I want to just convince myself, I'm not trying to convince y'all. I want to convince myself that Jesus absolutely rid himself of all of the strengths and abilities that he operated in his pre-existent state as God. If I can convince myself that Jesus didn't use any of these abilities and he had to do everything just like we do them today, then what we can do, we can just follow the example of Jesus, see what he did. Right? Follow his steps. Amen. And I believe that the same works, amen, that he did, we also can do. Amen. I remember saying that John 17, that was the scripture, John 18, 17, I believe. He says that after he had finished the works that God had called him to do. And I think that this is really important in the hour that we are confronting in terms of the things that we are going to be pursuing in the kingdom of God. Amen. We're going to be shortly going out and sharing it with those that's without. Amen. So this is St. John 17. He says that verse 3, and this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. I glorified thee on the earth. I finished the work which thou hast what? Thou gavest me to do. And now, O Father, glorify thou me with thine own self, with the glory which I had with thee before the world was. So he was praying that God would restore back to him the glory. So therefore, that's the reason why we say he laid aside his mighty power and glory. Amen. That's what Philippians 2, that I always read, let this man be in you that was also in Christ Jesus. Amen. He didn't think it was something that he had to retain or to hold on to, which was the equality that he had with God. He had all of these pre-existent powers, but he didn't retained those. He didn't hold on to them. He emptied himself. In other words, he relinquished all of these rights and privileges and powers. Amen. And he came down to function, amen, as a man, even to the point of giving his life, amen, for the world. Amen. So that encourages me. We do know he laid aside his mighty power in glory. Amen. Praise God. Now, what about in his humanity? What are some of the things that you can say about Jesus to let you know he was a man just like we were when it comes to his natural life? Amen.
Well, one was at the grave site of Lazarus, mm-hmm. Mary and Martha was talking with him, mm-hmm. and they were saying that's where he had been here when he died, and he could feel their heart, you know, their sorrow. It says he
All right, that's true. Jesus wept, so he was touched just like we can be touched in the natural.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Did he get tired?
Yes, he was very tired.
Yeah, he was very tired. So that means that what? That God part wasn't kicking in. God don't get tired.
He was very sleepy because they had to awake him.
That's right. He may have got so tired that he went to sleep and they had to wake him up.
Mm-hmm.
Because the boat was about to be what?
About to sink.
Amen. It was about to open. Amen. Okay. So all of these things are things. Now, did he have to grow in wisdom and in stature and in favor with God and man?
Yes.
All right. Okay. He had to grow in stature. So he didn't have all of the knowledge and wisdom.
No.
He had to learn, he had to read, he had to study, he had to pray, he had to learn from the scribes and Pharisees.
He was, the scripture says he was tempted in all points like as we are.
Right.
Yet without sin. So he was tempted with women.
All right, he was tempted in all points like as we are, yet without what?
Sin.
Mm-hmm.
That Satan had to be fasted.
Mm-hmm. So all of these things, okay, I'm sure that's good.
Now, if he wasn't immune to pain and injuries, mm-hmm. even the body suffered the same as man's body.
Right, when they pierced him and crucified him, and mutilated, beat beyond recognition, he had to suffer that, amen, just like any other person. He felt that, right? He went through that. That God, that then, so actually he was operating, amen, not as God, he was operating as what? Man. So him going through all of these points, all of these temptations and challenges, the Bible says that this enables him to relate to whatever conflict, problem, trial, up, down, sorrow, pain, amen, he can relate to whatever we went through, because if he hadn't gone through them as a man, then he couldn't be what? He couldn't relate. Amen. He couldn't be touched by the feelings of our infirmity. The Bible says since he's been tempted, amen, then he knows how to deliver them that are what? Tempted. Amen. One big one, amen. All of these make me know that if I do the same thing that Jesus did as a man, I will get the same results that he got. Amen. Because he's the same God that was working in him is the same God that's what? Working in me. The same Holy Spirit that was working in him, that same Holy Spirit. Amen. It's not an inferior Holy Spirit. Sometimes we might think it is. Amen. But it is still the same. Amen. And the Bible says Jesus learned obedience. Now, if he was perfect, if he operated only as God, amen, amen, why did he have to learn obedience? Amen. Scripture says he learned obedience through the things that he was, through the things that he suffered.
Suffering, we may not fully understand why we're suffering. I mean, it's like, why am I going through this, whatever. But he knew that, that of the joy of redemption of mankind. So, in other words, I think it's sometimes if we keep the vision of, you know, where we're going, why we're doing what we're doing, the discouragements and that, the anguish and the pain and the suffering and all that, it won't beset us so much if we can keep our eyes on the prize.
All right, so it means a lot to have a revelation and be able to see the end before, at the beginning. How many know that you can see the end results before you even begin? Amen. But you have to see it on your knees in prayer and the spirit, right? Amen. Sister Hill mentioned that his flesh recoiled when he faced the hour of temptation and the death of the cross. No. He said, Father, if there's any other way that your will can be done, amen, I'll be open for it. I'll be in agreement. If there's any other way, amen. So he prayed and his flesh was recoiled. He didn't want to go through that. He wanted, amen. He knew that it was going to be a lot of bitter agony and pain and suffering.
So likewise, a long time here, endure things.
It's kind of like, you know, for the joy of life, the woman that had children, you know, it's a lot of pain and anguish wearing children. Your, that said before, is after the birth. All right, that sounds like it might be true.
Yes.
I would never know. Amen. But Jesus was sweating. Jesus was sweating great drops of blood. So it was a whole lot of agony that he went through in the garden. And the amazing thing that I see in this also is that the Father, he says, Jesus himself declared that my Father is greater than I. Amen. That shows that now they pre-existed as, you know, the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit, God, and Jesus and Christ all pre-existed as what? One. They were all co-equal in what? Power, right? Amen. Before Jesus became humanity, they were all co-equal in power. They all pre-existed as what? God. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
Okay, but Jesus declared, he said, my Father is greater than I. So that shows that he was not operating, amen, in the strength of his what? Divinity. Amen. He was operating. He was still 100% God, but yet he was 100% what? Humanity. So he laid aside the godly attributes. He laid aside. In other words, he just refused to operate as God. Although he was 100% God, he could have just stepped back into that God body. Amen, and then operated as God, but that wouldn't have been an example for humanity. He wouldn't be relatable.
He wouldn't have fulfilled the plan.
He wouldn't have fulfilled the plan because man, it was a man that took us into what? Sin. Mm-hmm. Then it takes up what? A real man.
Mm-hmm.
To what? A human being to what? To bring us out. In fact, a human being anointed with God had to be the one that defeats Satan. Amen. But the Holy Ghost came to his rescue because the Holy Ghost always did the work through him. Amen. As a man. Amen. Praise God. Now here are some very interesting things I like to read. It says that Jesus performed all of the works that he was sent to do as a man anointed by God, and not as God, as he were in his pre-existing state. Everybody can agree to that? Say amen. All right, watch this. He never took credit for one miracle or work he performed, nor for one sermon he taught or preached. He attributed all the mighty deeds that were done through him to his Father and to the Holy Spirit. He said, the Father that dwelleth in me, he doeth the work. Is what Jesus himself said in St. John 14, 10. All the works that he did in his Father's name were done through the power of the Holy Spirit. All right? Jesus was just as dependent on the Holy Ghost as we are in our life today. Many, now I want you to watch this, many see Jesus in Jesus' ministry and works in a unique category unattainable by us today and not as men like us. Y'all believe that's true? Do you believe that many people see Jesus' works that he did in a different category than by the works that we are to do today? Amen. That was Jesus, but, you know, I'm no Jesus. That's what many times say. You know, I ain't no Jesus. I know better than that. I ain't going to hype myself up. Make me feel like I'm Jesus. I mean, I can do the works that Jesus did. But do you believe that most people see the works that Jesus did? Amen. He was anointed by his Father. Mm-hmm. Right? He was led by the Holy Spirit. He did them in the power of what? The Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. Do you think that many people today see those works, amen, in a different category than the works that we are commanded to do in Jesus' name today? Do you believe that most people feel that way? Maybe I should ask, do you feel that way? All right, to the very end. Come on, give me a response.
The question is, do most people feel what now?
Do you feel that most people think that, or maybe you can just apply to yourself, that the works that Jesus did in the power of the Holy Spirit, depending on God, in this category, but the works that I'm commanded to do is in another category. In other words, I have an unfair advantage because Jesus said what? Okay, well, we'll okay. Okay. In other words, we're just trying to see how y'all feel about this. We feel that Jesus' works is of a different nature, caliber, and there's... I could never expect to attain to the quality of works that Jesus did because, after all, he was God, and I'm just a man. Is that the way you think most people feel about it? Bottom line? Bottom line?
Yes.
Because, huh? Who said that we should? I'm not asking, should we? I'm asking, do we?
Yes, no, we should be able to wait.
Okay, Jesus' works, I can't ever attain unto that. Get way over here, man. I can't ever touch the works that Jesus did because just look over me. Hey, man, I ain't never been into heaven. All right, because, you know, until things like that are settled, we will always feel inferior, although Jesus said, behold, I give you power. Over all power of the enemy. Even power and authority. The same authority, same power, the same everything. But yet many times we feel that I will never be able to measure up to the works that Jesus did. Because after all, he was somebody special.
Turn
it water. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah,
have to ask yourself. Can I do that?
Okay, you're asking.
Don't you, brother? That I do that.
You know, okay.
I mean, probably that's somewhere in your mind, you know, and that's.
Mm-hmm.
That had been, he just
But he can read a life, read a past and all that.
Yeah.
Gifts of spirit and all that. Well, y'all tell me, how do you think that most people feel? Because, you know, if we looking at it wrong, I think that we ought to try to, what, correct the error in our thinking, and then whatever Jesus did, you know, maybe if we would begin to, Sister Hill said we got some belief problems.
I said maybe it's a belief problem. Maybe it's that, you know, if I saw some water there, I'm believing that I couldn't do that.
Yeah.
Maybe if I believed,
mm-hmm.
I could do it, maybe.
All right, well, let me, I don't want to get y'all too stretched out here. But when you begin to look back, you know, we have to look at it from the standpoint that Jesus spent many years, a few years, you know, he grew up, grew in wisdom, knowledge, and in the stature of wisdom and insight of God, stature. But remember, at 12 years old, Jesus was in the temple challenging Huga, the doctors of the law. And it could be that if a person comes up as a child like Jesus, that I guess this was typical of a lot of the Jewish kids. At age 12, they had great portions of the word kind of memorized, the Pentateuch. And they knew about all of the miracles in the Old Testament, probably. Is that right? And how many believe that that's a basis of faith when you can base your knowledge on things that God has done in the past? Kind of build on that. Okay, but let me tell you something that Sister Danita, suppose we went back and got every miracle that the Bible, anybody ever have one of these Bibles that have all of the Old Testament miracles and the New Testament miracles? Anybody have a Bible that tells you exactly where to find all of the miracles that were performed in the Old Testament? Now suppose you went back and meditate all of those miracles from the Old Testament and just focused on those, just dwell on those, and just got that anointing and got that really instilled into your spirit. Do you think that your faith in working miracles would be a problem? You think it would be a little easier?
Yes.
To believe God for miracles?
Amen.
Amen. If you meditated miracles, if you meditate healing, you're going to see what? Healings. If you meditate miracles, you're going to what? See miracles. If you meditate getting people filled with the Holy Spirit, that area of the word, you're going to be what? You're going to be successful in Amen. Getting people
yes.
filled with the Holy Spirit. So whatever you major on, whatever you focus on, amen, that thing that somebody said will expand.
Especially when that has happened to you.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, sister, she got one. She got all of the miracles. Now, I believe that whatever area of ministry that God has called you to work miracles, and I think that the Bible says that these signs shall what? Follow them that what? Believe. Amen. So suppose you went back and in my name you shall what? Speak in new tongues or cast out devils and lay hands on the sick and see them recover. Amen. Suppose you just went through the Bible and just focused on the people that Jesus spoke to and got them healed or laid hands on them. And the people that he cast devils out. And if, you know, if you major and meditated things like that, and then pray that God would what I really anoint you, I believe that your faith will begin to what? Grow in those particular areas. So more than likely, Jesus had already majored on all of these Old Testament stories. And that was the reason why I believe that when he preached to the multitudes, why so many of them were healed. Because Jesus mainly focused on the compassion, the mercy of God. And he always went back to the Old Testament where the mercy of God was released in the lives of those that were in desperate situations. Amen. Where's that in some? He brought them forth with silver and gold. And that was not one feeble person. See, That means that somebody resorted back, David said, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, who would forgive all thy iniquities, who would heal all thy diseases. So David's faith was what? Had developed in what? In the area of forgiveness and healing, those mercies. Because he went back and said what? He brought them all forth with silver and gold, and that was not what? One feeble person among their tribe. And you find that in the New Testament, Jesus often resorted back to Old Testament passages to relate some miracle that took place, amen, for someone whose faith was what? Was open, was developed, and people that were ready, amen, to have accepted and believed the word of God, and as a result of that, they received a miracle. Okay, so one thing we could say that would help all of us to develop our belief system would be what? Whatever area, she has them all of these miracles. And I believe, I need this Bible here. Is this a Bible?
No, it's not a Bible.
You know, I was thinking about it. I was thinking, right, okay, I say, that what will it take to move people today and get them in line and get them ready for Jesus' coming? I think it would take miracles. It's going to take what? Signs and wonders to get people, even with the fear of God.
People are attracted to miracles.
And it was in Acts 2, the Bible says they continued steadfast in the apostles' doctrine and prayers and breaking of bread and praising God. And the Bible says great fear came upon the people. Great fear. Do we need fear today in the church?
Yes, we do.
Do we need fear?
Right.
Amen. People, you know, don't fear God. He said, well, I can do whatever I want to. I don't have to line up completely with the word. I can just do as much of it as I want to do. Nobody will know it. Amen. Okay, so one attribute I think that perhaps that will distinguish Jesus from many of us that might cause us to see Jesus in a different light than we are, because Jesus perhaps... I guess he had more time to study, meditate. Let's make some excuse. You didn't have to work so hard on these jobs. These jobs, boy, they just kill you. Draws everything out. Oh, God. All right. But one thing, I think a lot of it is contingent upon what? Knowledge. And how many remember Catherine Kuhlman? They say that she prayed she spent the first 6 hours every day in prayer. It's praying the word. 6 hours. Dr. Cho, 3. So it does make a difference when you are alone with God and when you are in the word. Probably that would be more of a difference in the reason why perhaps we would have a tendency to place Jesus in a different category than us as individuals today, I would say. Would y'all say that? Maybe that's probably one of the... But then the ability to totally trust and depend upon God for his anointing and power. Now, how do you bring yourself to the point where you can just say, Lord, I'm totally, you know, you can say it with your mouth, but it's not always what you say with your mouth, but you got to what? Believe it in your heart. Lord, I'm totally and completely what? Trusting in you. Okay, how can you bring yourself around where you can, and how do you know when you're actually totally trusting and relying on God to do the work through you, and not you trying to do it yourself? Okay, now y'all can answer to that. How do you know that you've come to the point where you are totally trusting in God and not relying on the power of your own strength? Is a certain feeling you have? Or does a little bird come and whisper in your ear? Now you're totally trusting God. Anybody got any ideas? How do you know? When you are totally trusting God, how do you bring yourself to the point where you know that you're totally trusting God? I don't think none of us know completely how to totally do it, but what do you think may be some things you have to do? All right, Sister Sharon, what do you think?
I think when you're not relying on yourself, you just come in with yourself. So you just have to really just seek after Him. Just call Him and do the message for God.
Okay.
That's kind of from the latter where I'm saying that. When you have come to the end in yourself, let's say you're in a situation, you're at home, and you have absolutely no food in your house. Nothing. I don't think you got some beans and rice and corn or something you can scrap up. You have nothing in your house. And you have no visible means of getting anything. And you have no vehicle. I don't mean a car or anything. Just no way to get anything. And you come to the end of yourself, I should say. What does anything come into the end of yourself? You submit to the Father God and says, Lord, you know, here I am. You know, I'm at your mercy. I don't have, if you know the situation I'm in, and I'm asking for you, God, and your liberation. And I've heard of people praying those kinds of prayers and not having any means. And then, I'm sure it doesn't happen this way all the time, they go out on the front porch and they see a bag of groceries.
That's somebody knock on the door.
And they say, I don't know why I did that. Just the Lord led me to do this. And I think that sometimes you have to succumb to the end of yourself. Just say, I don't know where to go, what to do, where to turn. This is it. I just don't know what to do. And then I completely, totally.
Okay. All right, somebody else? Anybody ever been there? Okay, scripture says, if any man lacketh wisdom, let him what? Ask of God. So I think that one of the first things you can do is to what? Release the words.
Keep my hands up. No, I just
even though I trust them, I'm still trying to assist them in some way and make it happen because I don't know what the outcome is going to be.
Right.
Even though I'm trusting them, I'm still trying to help them.
Right.
But the thing is that showed me, I don't even worry about this. When it looked like it wasn't going well, he said to help my wife.
Mm-hmm.
And YouTube were a prime example of that help.